He's a child star who had it all.
Got the show on the air, you know, pretty much I could do what I wanted.
But his dream soon became a nightmare.
And I remember going up to the top of the hotel and literally was like just about to jump.
Meet the real Kel Mitchell on today's 700 Club Interactive.
On 700 Club Interactive, we use technology to pray for each other and explore topics that matter to you. Watch what God is doing in the world today.
Welcome to the show. People flock to Hollywood seeking fame and fortune. Some never make it past the first audition, while others hit the big time, like Kel Mitchell.
As a teenager, Kel was given his own Nickelodeon show. However, he soon discovered that he had too much too soon. And despite his fame, his life was falling apart.
I would define fame as in a trick. Fame is something that will gas you up to think that I did this and people know who I am now and it shouldn't be about you. Age of 14, I was living on the south side of Chicago. I started going on mini auditions. I got on a show called All That. We didn't really know as far as like the career move, how big that the show was gonna be. Even for the producers, all of us were like, wow.
As a sophomore in high school, Kel Mitchell starred on the number one show on cable TV's Nickelodeon channel. Soon he had a spinoff show and a major motion picture.
Had a house, everything, just, you know, hanging out on my own. Starting college, got the show on the air, you know, pretty much I could do what I wanted. A lot of times in the entertainment business, they glorify sex and drugs, and it's glorified like crazy.
Fame was good to Kel Mitchell. He had his choice of women. And while he started getting serious with one girl, the lure of fame was too much to handle.
I got drunk, right? And I got high for like the first time. We started going through Yellow Pages, and we went through these Yellow Pages. We were like, oh, let's just call some call girls just for fun. And ended up having sex with one of the girls.
Kel felt guilty and called his girlfriend to apologize and confess. But she had a confession of her own.
I told her what had happened and told me that she was pregnant with my baby. And so I flipped out, you know, to be young too, you know, in college and then on a television show. And then you also have someone pregnant at this point and you're on a kid's show. And this was the first time I actually started dealing with suicidal emotions. And she said, like, literally, let's get an abortion. And I agreed as well to get the abortion too. Like, it was both of our decision. She said that, you know, that abortion that we had was actually from another man. It wasn't yours. So at that moment, it was just like, okay, now I'm married to this person. And literally through that marriage, we went through a lot because it was literally like, okay, you know, we went into it with all these lies and deception, you know, and hurt and pain. Do you really love this person? Do this person loves you? Did you take the time to even find out who that was?
Kel decided to stay with his wife. They had two kids together. But Kel's wife continued to be unfaithful. And then Kel's show got canceled.
At this point, the show ended. I started to take other roles, but it started to basically have an up and down effect as far as in the career-wise. I was more upset at myself. It wasn't like, you know, Kel Mitchell, the actor, this, that, and the other. It was like Kel Mitchell, the man, like, what has happened to your life? What have you done? This can't be my life. What is going on? I have to save it. And even for my children, I have to figure out what to do. And it was just a lot of pressure. He basically told me that, look, man, she's pregnant. You know, we're tired of this. You know, I want to be with her. This is what's going on. And I remember going up to the top of the hotel and literally was like just about to jump because of the fact that I wanted to press an off switch. I felt like there needed to be an off switch. Like, you know, this wasn't what I had expected for my life, and I literally wanted just to end at that point. I literally did.
Kel decided to divorce his wife, and a custody battle began.
And they said, well, look, well, we're gonna just freeze visitation. There won't be any more until you guys kind of figure this out. And the hurtful part about it was that she was allowing my kids to go to the stop where I'm supposed to pick them up without letting them know that visitation had stopped at that point. So to them, it was, Daddy's not showing up. I went through a state of total depression. I ended up seeing myself at a one-bedroom apartment in a neighborhood that I wouldn't have been in before. I didn't have a car. It's lost so much money with the court and child support and so much to the point where it was just a little bit of money in the bank account. I remember electricity went out and I just cried and just sat there on the floor and it was like everything was taken away.
With no money, no family, and no friends, Kel met a minister who showed him there was more to life than fame.
You know, the only person that I could turn to at that point was Christ. And I started to go to this church. Things just started to change in my life. And I said, okay, that's it. I'm giving up drinking. I forgave my ex-wife. I let go of the anger. And what's beautiful about all this too is that as this was going on, I developed a friendship with my now wife. I thought I would never love again, you know, at all, you know, but I've loved again and my life is beautiful. I'm happy.
Today, Kel is married. He still makes movies and stars in TV shows. He talks to teenagers about the value of abstinence and has a message for those pursuing fame.
I feel like so many celebrities, they'll just show you who they are on stage. And we go through a lot. And I feel that if teens and kids and fans or whatever actually knew that, they can look at themselves and go, you know what, I can get through what I'm going through. Me coming from Chicago and being on television was because of the grace of God. There was no purpose to live, but now there's so much purpose for life. There's so much that needs to be done in the body of Christ, and I'm glad to be a part of it.
You can be glad to be a part of it too. You can actually come out of depression to have a hope and a future. How do you do it? Well, you do exactly what Kel did. He got to the point where he had no place to turn but Jesus. And when he did that and said, I surrender, I've tried to do it on my own, I've tried to do it my way, I surrender. And not just a little bit, but I surrender all. That's when the turn happens. Jesus is able to make you new again. He's able to give you a fresh start. He's able to completely change you. Where the Apostle Paul said, behold, all things are made new. He's able to do that. Now, what does it take to get it? Well, the same thing Kel went through. Are you at the point where your own plans and your own ways out haven't worked out? And are you ready to get to that point of surrender to say to Jesus, I've tried it my way. Can I try it yours now? Can I surrender all to you and let you do it for me? If you want to make that step, all you have to do is bow your head, pray a very simple prayer, and Jesus promises that he'll come in. He says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone, hear my voice and open the door, I'll come in. It's that easy. All you have to do is open. So pray with me. Let's pray together and let Jesus do for you what he did for Kel. He's no respecter of persons. He'll take you just as you are, and he's able to make all things new. Let's pray. Jesus, that's right, say it out loud. Jesus, I come to you today, and I need a change. I need a change in my heart, a change in my life, a change in my future. So Jesus, hear my prayer. Forgive me of the things that I've done wrong. Set me free. And most importantly, come into my heart. Make me new again. Give me the peace and the joy and the hope and the future that you've promised. Jesus, do this for me, for I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. The Bible says that if you'll believe in your heart and then confess with your mouth, you shall be saved. And well, I've made it easy for you to do just that. All you have to do is make a toll-free call. Number's on the screen, 888-777-1999. Just say, I prayed with that guy on TV, and I want to let people know I asked Jesus to come into my heart. When you call, we've got a free packet for you. It's called A New Day, and there's a CD teaching of how to live the Christian life. What do you do now? What are the principles of the Christian faith? What does it mean to be a Christian? Phone call's free, packet's free. Make it right now, 888-777-1999. Terry?
Well, coming up, find out how a bookie became an honest businessman right after this.
Every 40 seconds, a child goes missing. 800,000 children each year. 800,000 families' worst nightmare. No parent wants to believe their child is at risk, to think their neighborhood isn't a safe place, to even consider the unthinkable. But it's important to be prepared. How can you protect your child? On the 700 Club, next.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman, and I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child that you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you.
That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior.
If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free.
All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free.
I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program free.
Call the number on your screen now to get the Total Transformation free.
Well, the parents of the Nigerian man in our next story gave him the name Ojubore, but the people who knew him around town had a different name for him, Trouble.
Ojubore worked as a bookie and a bouncer and had a bad reputation all over town.
People were afraid of me. When they saw me walking their way, they would say, Trouble is coming, and run.
He led a wild life, spending everything he made on drinking, smoking, and parties.
I wanted to stop living such a bad life, but I realized that in spite of all the power I felt, I had no power to change my evil ways.
Ojubore started borrowing money to support his habits and was soon deeply in debt and depressed.
Everyone had deserted me. I was alone. I owned nothing and couldn't even afford to eat or drink.
Then one day, a pastor invited him to a meeting where tapes of CBN programs would be shown.
Many people had spoken to me about God, but this was different. So I decided to go to see for myself.
During the show, the host began to pray.
I immediately felt a strange presence leave me. I knew that what had tormented me all my life was finally gone.
Ojubore prayed and accepted Jesus Christ as his Savior.
I was flooded with joy. Instead of being filled with pride, I felt humble and happy.
Friends like Sunday, who have known Ojubore for years, can attest to the change in him.
He is so different now. Everyone used to be scared of him, but now he is a friend to every person he meets.
I will never forsake God. My household and I will serve him.
Ojubore is now married to Tolua, and they have a baby girl. Operation Blessing gave Ojubore money he needed to start his car washing business.
I will always give thanks to CBN. Thank you so much for these great things you have done for us, for my salvation, and for establishing a business for us.
Thank you. If you're a member of the 700 Club, you're part of blessing that wonderful man. If you're not a member, join with us. If you want to see the gospel preached around the world, We're doing it throughout Africa, throughout Latin America, and India, Indonesia, Philippines, Thailand. We're doing it on the internet around the world, all made possible because people like you care enough to give. So if that's you, join with us. Join the 700 Club. Now, how much is it? It's just $20 a month, 65 cents a day. And when you call and join, we'll send as our gift back to you Life Beyond the Grave, Part 2, a wonderful series of testimonies of people who died. Some went to heaven, some went to hell, but all of them came back to tell their story and how that changed their life. I want you to have it. It's yours when you become a member. So call us, 888-777-1999. Terry?
Well, coming up, what's it like to be married to the frontman for one of the biggest bands in Christian music?
I remember being in the back of a Chevy van in the way back where there's no seats, sleeping on a sleeping bag 6 months pregnant and bouncing around and just thinking to myself, I can't do this anymore.
Hear what kept this rocky marriage together when we come back.
Are there places around your home where you wish you had a light, but you don't?
Hi, Anthony Sullivan here for the Light Angel, the motion-activated LED light that sticks up in seconds and goes practically anywhere. It's like a guardian angel for your home that lights up the way for you, your family, and friends. Light Angel's weather-resistant adhesive sticks to practically anything. It's perfect for lighting up a porch, making a pool safer, and lots more. The Light Angel tilts back and forth so you get the perfect amount of light exactly where you want it. It swivels 360 degrees so you can light up almost anything. Stick it up by the front door, use it by the back door or a side entrance. It can even light up a shed. The Light Angel is the first one to see you coming and makes a great garage light. The secret's the technologically advanced motion detector that automatically activates the light whenever a human, pet, or automobile crosses its path.
Your home is far less likely to be broken into with a motion sensor light. That's why we recommend Light Angel to our residents.
It stays cool to the touch, and you can even use it indoors to brighten up a closet that doesn't have a light. And it's great under a sink or in tight spaces. Light Angel's 7 LED bulbs will stay bright for 100,000 hours. Use 4 AA batteries, stick up with no tools, and turns off after 60 seconds. Even when the power goes out, you can depend on the Light Angel to be your guardian angel. You could spend a fortune on a motion sensor light, and you need tools to install it. Or you could call or click now and get the stick up, motion activated Light Angel for $12.99. As part of this special offer, you can double the value. You can also get our best-selling old Brooklyn lantern, the vintage-style lantern with powerful LED technology. Light Angel, just $12.99. Call now for this amazing TV-only offer. When you order, find out about free shipping.
Call 1-800-207-9649. But hurry, and you can get an amazing second Light Angel and old Brooklyn lantern with your order. Call 1-800-207-9649. That's 1-800-207-9649.
The group Sanctus Real started in 1996 when a couple of 10th graders got together and formed a band. Led by singer Matt Hammett, they've released a string of number one hits and become one of the biggest names in Christian music. But while it all looked like Matt was a big success, life at home was a different story.
Marriage started out as an adventure for Sanctus Real's Matt Hammett and his wife, Sarah.
The first 4 years that we were full-time on the road as a band, Sarah was with me.
We had a lot of great times. I would say our relationship grew immensely. But resolving conflict on the road was really difficult.
We really didn't have much privacy. And it really, I think, caused us to not have healthy communication. And because of that, I think we would kind of bottle up a lot of our feelings, a lot of our frustrations that we would have. It can kind of cause a passive-aggressive type of communication.
Life changed dramatically for the Hammetts when Sarah got pregnant with their first child.
I remember being in the back of a Chevy van in the way back where there's no seats, sleeping on a sleeping bag 6 months pregnant and bouncing around and just thinking to myself, I can't do this anymore. So that's when I threw in the towel and I stayed home from that point forward.
It was hard to change our life like that. You know, it was hard for me not to have her on the road anymore. And it was hard for her not to be out seeing new things and meeting new people.
It was also difficult for both of them to adjust when Matt came home after the baby was born.
the hard part about traveling all the time too is that when you come home, you literally just want it to be perfect because you dream of getting back in your house, seeing your family. So you always want to make the most of the little time that you have. The expectations for me were that I would come home and it would just be a place of rest and refuge.
I had the mentality like, my time's over and you're up. Like, you gotta do all the grunt work and it's your turn.
I walked through the door with both of us having great expectations on each other. And when we felt that disappointment and then we started to vent our feelings and our frustrations, it'd be really easy for those arguments to get out of control, for our emotions to get out of control really quickly.
We had expectations that seemed logical and acceptable to have towards each other, and then we would fail each other, and then we would grow bitterness and contempt. And it was so deceiving. It really hit itself well, because it's really hard to call out your own contempt for someone because you feel you have a right to it.
It got to a place where the cycle that we were in of arguing just felt like we just could not get along.
Matt and Sarah were committed to making their marriage work, so divorce was not an option. They laid aside their bitterness, went to counseling, and tried to take ownership of their faults. But Sarah still felt something was missing.
We were starting to make changes, and I said, that's fantastic, but I really need you to, like, be the leader in our home.
That was the day that God just used her specific words to really break my heart and to really seal inside of me what he'd already begun in terms of just teaching me to be more teachable in terms of the kind of man that I am, the kind of leader that I am for my family. That day that we had that conversation is the day that I sat down and looked around me. I looked at all the pictures in our house, and I looked at the pictures of her smiling and our kids smiling. I looked at a photo of her wedding day, and my heart really ached because I felt as though I hadn't seen that glow in a long time. And I just wanted it back so desperately, and just cried out to God in that song that afternoon.
Lead me with strong hands, stand up when I can't.
I started expressing her heart and what my kids might say to me one day if I'm not a good leader to them. And really expressing my heart to just be the kind of man who fights for my family. And not by fighting, not by being stubborn, but fighting by just laying it all down at the feet of Christ and saying, Lord, you know what? I'm weak. You're strong. Every breath is just gonna have to be grace from you to be this man. The whole song, Lead Me, about being a leader is ultimately in the end saying, hey, I can't do this by myself. You know, I'm leading my family by saying, Father, lead me because I'm not capable of this.
Even just that understanding, once somebody says, I know I'm this way and I really do want to change, that really helped us move forward when we finally accepted our weaknesses, even though we thought we were all along.
Today, Matt and Sarah's marriage is stronger than ever. The relationship was tested again earlier this year when their third child, Bowen, was born with a serious heart defect.
I think feeling like we were in a really good place in our marriage and we're learning how to deal with that conflict better, it really prepared us because there's so much stress in having a sick child.
There was a purpose for what we went through, a God-ordained purpose. I believe it, and he's pulling us through it, and he's showing us his grace. And now I think when there's conflict, we understand that, you know, there's hope here. There's a purpose. It's not the end of the world. We can work this out. And it gives us that much more hope and that much more fuel to just keep working through it in ways that glorify the Lord more and more. It's just God's grace. In our weakness, he's strong.
God's got a plan. God's got a plan for it all. You know, we were created to live in relationship with him and in relationship with each other. Is it easy? No. You know, one of the things Matt said was he came to a place where he said, I'm going to lay it all down. God waits for us to come to that place, to come to the end of us, so that we understand how incredibly deeply we need Him. At the same time, He never calls us to anything that He doesn't give us provision for. And most of the time, the provision is Him. He is all that we need in every area of our lives. When we come to the end of us, that's where He begins. He's standing there waiting, waiting for you to do what Gordon talked about doing a few minutes ago, to just say, come in, come in. I'm done, I can't do this anymore. I want you, I want to do it your way. And so God's speaking that to you today. Maybe you're struggling in your marriage like Matt and Sarah were. Maybe you've got a sick child and there's all kinds of pressure and many unknown factors involved in that. You're filled with anxiety, fear, worry. You know, for every one of us, it's a different thing, but the result needs to be the same. The result needs to be that we come to the end of us and we begin to understand that that's where real life begins, the kind of abundant life that Jesus talked about, where He comes in and He is our grace, He is our mercy, He's our strength. He's the one who comes in and wipes away fear and replaces it with faith. The one who teaches us what it means to let go of being self-centered, self-focused, and to truly love and care about each other. He's the one who changes us, who says, I've got a better way, a better plan. And so today the question isn't whether God is able to do what needs to be done in your life. He's more than able. The question is, are you ready to invite Him in to do that kind of work? It's as simple as talking to Him. It's a relationship. He wants to communicate with you and He wants you to recognize He's here and communicate with Him. So just invite Him. Acknowledge your shortcomings, the places you've fallen down. Ask Him for forgiveness. You get a whole new beginning with Him. Bible says if any man or woman is in Christ, they become a brand new creation. Old things pass away. Everything becomes brand new. That's for you today. Ask Him to come in, to forgive your sins, to be the Lord of your life, to begin to show you and teach you how to live in Him and with Him and for Him. And He will be faithful to produce that in you. If you have a specific need and you'd like to talk to someone, pray with someone about it, call that toll-free number on your screen. It's 1-888-777-1999. The person who says hello on the other end is someone who's already prayed that prayer, and they're there today waiting for you. So call. Gordon?
Well, let's go over to Dimitri in the chat room.
We have Natalie that chatted in. She says, my daughter is convinced that she is going to make a video on YouTube, and she keeps trying to post them. She will be famous, she thinks, and she spends all of her time trying to get noticed, and I'm concerned. Should I do something?
I'd just let her go. I like the joy of youth. I like that she's aspiring to this, but she's some things you have to learn on your own. One is it can be really hard to make it, and you get into the whole universe of YouTube, and if you think one video is going to go viral, then, you know, how do you repeat that? And for every, you know, Bieber and Gangnam Style that makes it and then makes a career out of it, how many others didn't? So allow your children to experiment, and I really believe in encouraging children. So encourage her and then sort of walk her through the process. Let's go back to Demetria for one more chat.
Joy Chatson, she says, I've led worship at my church for a few years now, but I've always wanted to be a professional singer. Every time I've tried to audition or strike out on my own, something has always stopped me. How can I tell if God wants me to give something up or fight to hold on to something?
What's your heart's desire? If your heart's desire is for this, I would encourage you, God wants to give you your heart's desire. That said, you've picked one of the toughest businesses in the world to crack into, and music business, I've heard, is 90% business and 10% talent. So, you know, the one question I have for you, the best way to crack in, write a hit song. And if you're a writer, you'll find a lot of people will come your way. That's all the time we have. We leave with this word from John 16. I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world.